Namaste, and welcome to another episode of Ulladu-Narpadu. Today we're going to talk about those who have known and those who have not. We're going to read two verses because they make a complete thought. To those who have not known the self, and to those who have known, this defective fleshy body is I. But to those who have not known self, I is limited to only the measure of the body. Whereas to those who have known self within the lifetime of the body, I, the self, shines without limit. Know that this indeed is the difference between them. To those who do not have knowledge of the self, and to those who do have knowledge of self, the world is seen in front of them as real. But to those who have not known self, the reality is limited to the measure of the world, its names and forms. Whereas to those who have known self, the reality abides, devoid of name and form, as the substratum of the world. Know that this indeed is the difference between them. So, in Bhagavad Gita it is said, out of many thousands among men, only one may strive for self-realization. And out of many thousands who strive for it, only one may know it in truth. It means out of millions and millions of men, maybe 1 in 10 million will actually get it. So most of those who live have not known. They have not seen the self within themselves. They have only seen the world, which appears to be outside. But those who have seen the self know that the world is actually within the self. It's a dream. It's a mechanical device, a construction, similar to a house of cards. But instead of cards, it's made of name and form. So if we think about the world, what we're really thinking about is a model, a construction. Within our minds, we have constructed a model made of names and forms. And these are stacked on top of each other, like a house of cards. It's a beautiful example that the self is actually the substratum, like the table. And then the house of cards is built on top of that table. So the reality is there, but it's hidden by the construction. This artificial mechanism, this clockwork machine called the world. Now, those who have known the self, and it's interesting the expression, have known. In the original, he doesn't mention the word self. He says just those who have known, those who have not known. Because in previous verses, he already established that the only knowable thing, the only real knowledge, is knowledge of self. So for those who have known, why doesn't he say for those who know? Because when we are in action in the world, it's impossible to also remember the self. Why is that? Because to remember the self means we drop all ideas of location, movement, objects, anything other than the self. So when we're immersed in the self, this is called nirvikalpa samadhi. Now there's also a kind of samadhi called savikalpa samadhi. And in savikalpa samadhi, one sees the world as within the self. And in that samadhi, action is possible. But it's not like one is thinking of the self. One is still thinking of the world, but not as a world. See, the one who has not known the self thinks of the world as a world, and that he is a tiny living being within that world. But one who has seen, one who has known, knows that actually the world, what we call the world, exists within the self. What is the proof? At night, when we dream, so many self-consistent worlds are created, full of people, animals, trees, buildings, landscapes, everything. Anything and everything that exists in the waking world can also exist in the dream world, and also many things that do not exist in the outside or waking world exist in the within or the dream world. Now, some people are going to say, well, the real world is self-consistent. It's even mathematically consistent, and we can derive scientific laws from its observation. Well, yeah, sure. And if you go in your dream world and start observing and performing scientific experiments, they will also be self-consistent. Why? Because the same mind makes both of them. But when you go into the world of deep sleep, without mind, without ego, there is no world. There is only self. And when most people go into that world, they're still wearing their Ananda Maya Kosha, which is the shroud of deepest ignorance. So they don't perceive anything. But if you go into it with awareness, then you will perceive the self. So sometimes people ask me, well, how do you do this? You know, everybody wants to know how. No, first you have to know what. Then only you can talk about how. That's why in these videos we concentrate on the what. Actually, Ramana is leading because he's writing the verses that we're talking about. And he talks extensively about what. He talks more about how in Upadesha Undiyar. But here he's talking about what. What is the world? Whoa. What is the world? Huh? What kind of existence is it really? It's certainly not as we usually think of it, because we know we're in illusion. But it's not really that different either. The example is given of the rope and the snake. One who is dreaming, hallucinating, in ignorance, deluded, sees the snake. But one who is awake, who is sane, who is in knowledge, sees that it's just a rope. Now, both of them think that the snake or rope, whatever they happen to see, is real. They both are convinced of the reality of their experience. Why? because to them, it seems self-consistent. To each one, the one who sees the snake also feels the fear and also experiences running away and hiding and so on. The one who sees the rope is not disturbed, and his world also exists in congruence with his experience. So what is it really? If we're both with knowledge and those without knowledge are convinced that their experience is real. So how can we tell the difference? Well, the difference is that one has an experience of the self, the other doesn't. That's really the simplest thing. Really the simplest difference. Now, why do some people become enlightened and most people don't? This is really the point that I want to make in this video. Since Ramana brings it up here, very conveniently. Because some people, or I should say most people, don't want to mess with their house of cards. They're afraid to disturb the cards at the bottom because the whole thing may fall, isn't it? Oh my God, what if I discover that there really isn't any such thing as a world out there? What am I gonna do? Oh, I know what you're gonna do. Because I've already been through it. It's all right. It's not going to hurt you. But try to convince someone of that who has never had any experience in transcendence. They're going to be frightened. They're going to be scared to death. That what if I mess with my worldview? What if I disturb the cards in the bottom of the stack and the whole house of cards collapses? Then what am I going to do? That's not the right question to be asking. But let's take a look at it anyway, okay? Let's say somebody comes to a master, and this happened hundreds of times, if not thousands of times, in Ramana's lifetime. That someone came to him and began to ask questions about enlightenment. And he gave them answers that just blew their minds. They were expecting to be told, well, there's a wonderful cartoon, which I'm going to put up on the screen here. And of course, this is one of the variations on the theme of climbing the mountain and meeting the master. What does it mean, Mr. Natural? The guy climbing the mountain has a head which is like a Rubik's Cube, and it's all scrambled. In other words, he's confused. He needs to know what is what. And he's coming to the guru to get his cube solved. And he climbs up there and he meets the master, and whoa, the master's head is a sphere filled with swirling colors. Not what he expected at all. What does it mean? It means there is a gap in the beingness between an unenlightened and an enlightened person. It means there's a gap, a huge difference in the way they see the world, in the way they think, and in the way they are inside. One of them has this model, the mind, which is supposed to be a mirror of the world. And the other one doesn't really need it. So what if the cards all fall down? Don't really need it anyway. See, a person who lives in knowledge sees the cause or the substrate on which everything is built directly. There's no need for inferential knowledge. Everything we think we know about the world is just an inference. It's just an assumption based on something that we were told. Has anybody listening to this video gone out and proved that space exists, that time exists, that the world exists in reality? Or do you just assume it because everybody says so? And are you afraid to question these assumptions because, oh my goodness, what will people think? Are you afraid to look into it because you might find out that they are simply assumptions, that they're not proved, they're not written in stone? What would happen to your little world? See, everybody here has this tremendously delicate structure, which is built up of other tremendously delicate structures. And so they're very much afraid that any little change will destabilize the whole thing. So now you have a situation in the world where the actual enlightened people are not believed and cannot get a following. Because, oh my God, they might say something that's going to destroy our little world. I'll tell you what, I live in a holy place which was established by the highest teacher in 2,000 years, at least. And all of his direct disciples are in hiding. The few that are still alive, just a handful of them. They don't see anybody. They don't give public talks. They don't grant interviews. They live in isolation, in seclusion. Why? Because the last few generations have seen the arising of a whole milieu of phony spiritual teachers, performance artists who talk the talk but don't walk the walk. And how is that? Because they're telling people what they want to hear instead of the truth. And they have the PR staff, and they have the events management staff, and they have, you know, all the stuff that it takes to get by in today's business world. And they've turned it into a business. And they're making thousands and thousands of disciples and thousands of dollars. And the real authentic enlightened people are sitting alone, because nobody is willing to come to them and hear the truth that is going to destroy their little house of cards. This is what's going on now. And the only reason it can happen is that people are afraid. Well, what are you afraid of? You're going to lose the status quo. Big deal, you're going to lose it anyway. There's nothing that you can lose from approaching a real master that you're not going to lose anyway just by the influence of time. Right now we live in a very precarious time. The old order is about to shatter, or it's actually in the process of shattering. The system of civilization, the system of culture all over the world is unsustainable. And it must change radically. It will change radically. Everyone's lives are going to be uprooted. Yes, even the rich. There is no escape. It's going to be a global transformation of everything, from one house of cards to another. That's all. But the point is, everybody's house of cards is going to fall. It's been a long time coming, but now is the time. So if you become enlightened, or you approach a teacher, and you get your little house of cards shaken up, there's no loss. But rather, if you really want enlightenment, do it now. There isn't any more time to waste. You won't be able to coast anymore. Time is very short. The change is overdue. We're about to get billed for all that stuff we put on the card. So, my advice to anyone who is really sincere is to contact someone who has known the self. Contact someone who sees. Huh? Oh yeah, I was going to say something about how. Just to make sure you stay tuned until the end of the video. In the interval between sleep and waking, there is a moment where there is nothing but the screen, the background, the substrate, the self. You have to catch that moment and then hold on to the self. This is the best method. This is what I do. And this is recommended by Ramana too. So, just falling asleep at night, when the mind becomes quiet, and then the dream starts, then stop the dream. Don't wake up, just stop the dream. And only the substrate remains. Or, first thing in the morning, the dream ends. But waking consciousness hasn't begun. So the same thing, let the dream end. Don't wake up, but just hold to the substrate, hold to the self. Now I gave away all my secrets, but you know what? I would bet 99% of you will be unable to do this method. Why? Because all kinds of preliminary training is necessary first. And you haven't done it. The reason you haven't done it is because you don't have a master. And the reason you don't have a master is because you're chicken. That maybe you're going to disturb your little house of cards. So you miss. Oh well. There's always next lifetime, right? No, there is only now. So you can get it or you can miss. It's up to you. Om Tat Sat. Om Hari Om.